Good morning, students. I welcome you all in my today's class, which is going to be a real-time audio-video streaming. And our today's topic of discussion is glycolysis. Glycolytic pathway, different cellular respiratory pathways, and their mechanism and their different enzymes involved that we will discuss in our class. So before entering that specific topic, let me describe what is the respiration, what does it mean? So respiration, sometimes we are having some confusions regarding whether this glycolysis and the TCA, these are also sometimes called as respiration. Sometimes that the inspiration and expiration, the breathing, that is also known as the respiration. So what is the difference? We can differentiate in the form that one is the intracellular respiration, another one is the extracellular respiration, or one is known as the external respiration. External means which is going on between our body cells and the external environment, that is breathing. When we are inspiring or the expiring, what is going on? The gas exchange is taking place between the air, which is present inside the alveoli, and our blood. And second one, from the blood to the tissues. So that is the external respiration. So, but our concern for today's class is the internal respiration. Now, what is the internal respiration? That is actually known as the cellular respiration, which is going on inside the cell, not outside, inside the cell. Now, the question is why it is going on inside the cell. The answer is that since cell is the, the main mechanics which is maintaining our all the body functions, regulating our maybe the nervous system and everything, all the whole body. If there is a life, if a person is living or if an animal is living, the cells are the main main mechanics or the main employee of that one, which is maintaining. So that is one reason why this internal respiration is going on in the cell. Second most important thing is the triggers or that tools which are required for the all these pathways, that means the enzymes. All these enzymes are present in the cell itself, and that is the most important reason why this all these intracellular respiration pathways are always occurring inside the cell. Maybe in the different regions, because we know cell is having different regions, sometimes in the nucleus, sometimes in the cytoplasm, or sometimes maybe in the nucleus but inside the in the cytoplasm but maybe inside some other subcellular organelles, like maybe inside the your mitochondria, inside the some maybe in the ribosomes, or maybe in the some other subcellular organelles. So that is the internal respiration. Number of metabolic pathways are there, but the most, some of the importance of some of the popularly known pathways are, as we know, you also know that glycolysis, TCA, electron transport chain, other type of pathways are there. So there, two types of conditions are there, whether the oxygen is present or whether the oxygen is absent. What is the importance of that oxygen? It is required for the oxidation. During the oxidation or the reduction processes, oxygen is always required. You will get it know in the next the metabolic pathways where and when or how oxygen is required. So anaerobic or the anaerobic respiration. Aerobic means when the oxygen is present, or if the organism is a oxygen requiring organism, or the if the organism is does not require oxygen, or maybe hypoxia, or the oxygen is not present there. So what may be the hypoxia? Or what is the organism which don't require the oxygen? The bacteria don't require the oxygen. So they are the anaerobic organisms. But the ourselves, me and you all, we require the oxygen. That is, we are the aerobic organism, or the the condition we are having inside our cell is the aerobic one. Second thing is that what is the anoxia? Anoxia means, or the hypoxia means, say for example the muscles. When muscles are doing their normal activities, that is okay. But when it is having the vigorous activity, so that muscle can be, if it is having the, number of activities, vigorous activity, so it will require more number of oxygen. So that is the respiration. Aerobic and the anaerobic. So in case of the muscle, what I was telling that in last time, that what is the muscle? when there is vigorous exercise, the muscle needs, muscle can cope up with the availability of the oxygen and the requirement of oxygen. For that time being, when the oxygen requirement is less than its requirement, that for that moment, specific moment, the anaerobic condition appears in case of us also, in case of our muscles, the that is the striated muscles, skeletal muscles mainly. So at that generally the anaerobic respiration. Now if we move, so glucose is the main energy generating molecule in case of us. Others are there, protein, carbohydrate, all these are there, but the carbohydrate is giving the most energy, most prominent part of the energy, other than the protein and the fats, fatty acids. So as we know, different types of carbohydrates are there, mono, dry, saccharide or polysaccharides are there. So glucose is the monosaccharide, the simplest sugar, which is the glucose. So that will give us the energy through the pathway which is known as the glycolysis. So by the process of glycolysis, the end product, just look at this figure, at the end of the glycolysis, the end product is the pyruvic acid or the pyruvate, plus it is giving us the most important thing, which is ATP. So ATP actually will require for different number of cellular activities. ATP plus that pyruvate, if it will go further, if it will proceed further, it will give us more number of energy. So at the end of glycolysis, we are getting some energy and something which will give us more energy in next steps. But this is shown by one arrow, but this is not, I mean, there is not the single step, there is number of steps are there. What is the steps? Next slide I will tell you. After the production of the pyruvate, what is the next step? What is the preceding steps? So after the production of pyruvate, if the condition is up to this, glycolysis is the aerobic one. After that, if that aerobic condition sustains, if the aerobic condition still remains, that causes the entry of this pyruvate. It will convert into something else that I am not going to tell you. In next class I will tell something else. That pyruvate will transform, and then it will enter the mitochondrial matrix. In the mitochondrial matrix, that TCA cycle is going on in presence of oxygen. That means if the condition is aerobic, and that will give us carbon dioxide, H2O and the ATPs. Second one, look at your left side. If there is the lack of oxygen, or if the organism is anaerobic one, say for example the yeast, the bacteria, they will produce from this pyruvate, that means from this pyruvate they will produce the ethanol and the carbon dioxide. Third condition, your right side, if the muscle is the muscle is from us, the aerobic organism, but for that time being the requirement of the oxygen and the demand of the oxygen by the muscle is not same. That means the muscle is now facing the hypoxic condition or the anaerobic condition. Now during this anaerobic condition, from the pyruvate, the muscle will produce lactic acid. These are the three conditions. But one important thing is that glycolysis is there. Obviously, if you need the energy from the glucose, first you should go through the glycolysis, which will give you pyruvic acid. Now if the condition of anaerobic condition is sustained, then it will enter the mitochondria, it will give us that all these things, CO2, H2 and the energy. If the it is in case of the muscle, and the muscle is exercising, that produces the anaerobic condition and it will give the lactic acid. But if it is in case of the yeast, the bacteria, that will give us the ethanol and the carbon dioxide. So this is the today's topic, that is the glycolysis, known for you maybe from the class 8 or 9, for all of us, not only for you. What is the glycolysis? If somebody will ask, what is glycolysis? Just simply tell them that it is the process where the glucose will be broken down to produce some ATP. Final product will be the pyruvic acid. Where it is going on? Inside the cell. So glycolysis refers to the process of breakdown of glucose into pyruvic acid in the cell cytoplasm. That's it. So what about the other carbohydrates other than the glucose? Yes, other carbohydrates are also there, and they are also oxidized through this glycolysis, glycolytic pathway, to produce the pyruvate. There are some other separate enzymes which will transmit other carbohydrates other carbohydrate like say for example glycogen is there, polysaccharides, fructose, galactose, mannose, and some other carbohydrates are there. They will become oxidized, and they will enter in the glycolysis pathway, and at the end they will give us the pyruvate. What is the site? The site is the cytosol. Why? Because all the enzymes are present in the cell cytoplasm. That's why the glycolysis is occurring in the cytosol. Some lines are given that it occurs in all the living cells. Obviously, since all the living cells require energy, so it is it must be there in all the cells. Second one is the most important, that is the principal energy generating pathway for RBC is the glycolysis. Just remind that since there is no mitochondria there, so the electron transport chain as well as the that I mean what is that TCA cycle, the TCA cycle and the electron transport chain is not going on, not occurring in the case of RBCs, since the RBC is the only cell in case of human which is having no nucleus plus having no mitochondria. There is no mitochondria in the RBC. So in absence of mitochondria, the electron transport chain and the TCA cycle is not there in the RBC. So how the RBC will produce the oxygen, I mean the ATP? By the means of this glycolysis. So glycolysis is the only pathway, no other pathways is possible for the production of ATP in case of RBC. So that is the importance of glycolysis. So the glycolytic pathway, which is the glucose utilization, entry of glucose into the cell, first preparatory phase, and it produces the energy. Plus, it not only produces energy, for the beginning, for some of the steps, it requires the energy. See, sometimes when you start anything, maybe any work, you are pulling some chair or something, something maybe. So, say for example, just assume that there is some wheels are attached. Okay, but initially, first when you are starting, when you are pulling it, it requires little energy. Then if you pull it, it will go by its own, maybe by its own due to its kinetic energy, because it is having some bearing and all these wheels and all everything. But initially you need some energy. So in the same case, in case of the glycolysis, initially it will need some energy, some in the form of ATP. That is, that we can say that that is the wastage of energy. But in the end, what the energy we are using, that glycolysis is using, and then what the energy the glycolysis is giving us, the sum total is plus. That is, at the end of glycolysis, we are gaining some ATP energy. That some reaction is given, that from glucose we are getting the pyruvate, or if it will enter, that glucose if it will enter through the pentose phosphate pathway, another pathway is there, which is known as the pentose phosphate pathway, it will give us ribose 5-phosphate. Or it may be stored in case of the muscle or in case of the some livers. I mean, a liver, it will store in the form of glycogen or the starch or the sucrose. That is the storage form of glucose. Or it will undergo through pyruvate and give us energy, or ribose 5-phosphate, that will also give us energy. So this pathway is also known as that, I mean, in the name of scientists, actually three scientists are there, Emden, Meyerhoff and the Parnas. Three scientists are there. And that pathway is named after their inventors. These are three scientists are the inventors. So, see, the same pathway is showing here. Glucose, it will giving us the 2-pyruvate, which is aerobic one. If the aerobic conditions sustain, it will form 2-acetyl-CoA. And finally, it will give us the carbon dioxide, H2O, and the energy. In case of muscle, it will give us the lactate. In case of the anaerobic organisms, it will give us the ethanol. Now the glycolysis. That is the NCN pathway which is going on in the cytoplasm. Generally, no oxygen is required. Oxygen requirement is not there in case of the initial stage of glycolysis. So what does it mean? Is it the aerobic one, the anaerobic one? Oxygen is not requiring. But the, I mean, it does not depend on whether oxygen is present or not. But still, it is considered as the aerobic pathway. The glycolysis is considered as the aerobic pathway, but the condition is that oxygen may or may not be required. So it does not mean it will not stop. If oxygen is there or not there, it will not stop. It will go on. But after the production of pyruvate, that is the important one. Whether oxygen is present, if it is present, it will go through one route. If oxygen is not there, it will go through another route. So it is used for the energy production, production of the intermediates for other pathways. Some of the intermediates are produced that will give us, that will enter to other pathways and that will give us energy through some other biochemical pathways. It is found in tissues with limited blood supply also. So the reaction is like this. It will start from the glucose, since glucose is entering. Then how many steps are there? Just count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So 9 total steps are there. 9 enzymes are involved, which is starting from the glucose and ending at the pyruvate. So where the ATP is required, the ATP is wasted, used. Step number 1, then step number 3. These are the two steps where ATP is used. Where ATP is produced, this is in the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Step number 6 and the step number 9. These are the two steps where the ATP is produced. 1 and 3 ATP used, 6 and the 9 ATP is generated. Also, we are getting NADH plus H plus, which is further giving us energy in the form of ATP when this NADH will go through the electron transport chain. So let us describe in detail. What is the first step? The first step is glucose will enter. It's present in the cell. First, glucose will enter to the cell. How glucose will enter to the cell? Any idea how glucose will enter? The glucose must enter the cell now. Since we are, say for example, I will take some glucose or some player is taking some glucose in the field. Now glucose must enter the cell. The glucose will travel, or you have taken some bread or something, rice or some carbohydrate. That carbohydrate is now digested by carbohydrate digesting enzyme. Then all these digested food materials, some of these food materials which are not for use, they will be excreted. Rest of the food materials will be absorbed by the villi. Then that absorbed material will, just think about this, that absorbed material will transport through our blood. Then it will reach to the tissues where it actually needs. Now in case of the tissues, now imagine the condition. In the tissues, number of cells are there. The blood is bathing the tissues. The blood is flowing the tissues. And the blood is having full of glucose. Is there any chance of glycolysis there? No, there is no chance until or unless the glucose is entering to the cell. Now, how the glucose will enter into the cell? All the glucose molecules should enter to the cell. Some specific transporters are there. Since we know the cell is covered by the cell membrane, no one can directly enter or go out of the cell without the permission of the cell itself. So, some transporters are there which will transport glucose. These transporters are known as the GLUT, G-L-U-T, GLUT transporters. Number of types are there, but these are GLUT transporters which will transport glucose from the blood, that is from the outside the cell, to the inside the cell. Okay, now assume that the glucose is able to enter the cell. So what is the first step? One enzyme which is known as the hexokinase, that enzyme is the capability to convert this glucose into glucose 6-phosphate. At the 6th position, one phosphate will be added. That will form the glucose 6-phosphate. Just read the name again, hexokinase. Just remind, you can note it down. Kinase is an enzyme. It may be hexokinase or phosphofructokinase, where kinase is added. The kinase actually means the enzyme which is capable of adding some phosphate. I repeat, the kinase is the enzyme which is capable of adding some phosphate group. So that means kinase is adding some phosphate. So there are some other enzymes which are able to degrade or cleave the phosphate. That type of enzyme is known as phosphatase. So kinase is adding some phosphate at the 6th position of glucose. Now it will be converted into the glucose 6-phosphate. There, that is the first step, and there one ATP energy is required, because from the triphosphate, one phosphate is transferred by this kinase enzyme into the 6th position, 6th carbon position of the glucose molecule, and thereby, since adenosine triphosphate minus 1-phosphate, now the remaining thing is the adenosine diphosphate. Okay, what is the second step? The second step is Just a minute. The second step is this one. This glucose 6 phosphate is transformed into, isomerized into, that is known as the isomerization, glucose to fructose. Phosphate is being given in the 6th position, okay, but the glucose is isomerized into the fructose. I'll show you the what is the change in the structure in next slides, then you will get it more a better idea. So the glucose is isomerized into fructose 6 phosphate by the action of enzyme phosphoglucose isomerase. That is the second step. No energy required, no energy is generated. What is the third step? In the third step, this fructose 6 phosphate is converted into fructose 1,6 biphosphate. That means in the first position, another phosphate is added. It was fructose 6 phosphate. Now it is having fructose 1,6 bisphosphate or biphosphate. Someone is called as biphosphate also. That means another phosphate is added to the first carbon position of the fructose. So from where this phosphate comes? From the adenosine triphosphate, the third alpha, beta, gamma. That alpha phosphate is coming and added to there. So it is transformed into ADP. So that is the waste is the one ATP energy. The enzyme is phosphofructokinase 1, PFK1, sometimes it is known. That is the third step, where another ATP energy is wasted, used. The fourth step, that is the fourth step, where this fructose 1,6 bisphosphate or the biphosphate with the action of the enzyme aldolase is changed into, maybe into the two forms or any one of the forms, plus with the action of another enzyme, this one kind of form can be transmitted into another one. Let me explain. This fructose 1,6 bisphosphate with the action of the enzyme aldolase is converted into two molecule glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate or the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate and the dehydroxyacetone phosphate. Which molecule is forming? That there is another enzyme which is known as the triose phosphate isomerase. This enzyme has the capability of reversible reaction. How it is reversible? Either glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate may be converted into the dihydroxyacetone phosphate or the vice versa. Or that means the dihydroxyacetone phosphate can be converted into glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate or vice versa by the action of enzyme triose phosphate isomerase. So that is our fourth and the fifth step. What about the next one? Let us check. So our next step is sixth step. What is sixth step? Where this glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate is converted into 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate. Two molecules. Just mind it, two molecules are there. So that means in the fourth step, this fructose 1,6 bisphosphate is converted into glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate. Two molecules, not a single. That means fructose 1,6 bisphosphate, the condition is that either it is forming one molecule glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate and one molecule dihydroxyacetone phosphate. Now this dihydroxyacetone phosphate is converted into glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate. That is the fifth reaction. Or from this fructose 1,6 bisphosphate, it is directly forming glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, two molecule. So anyhow, we are getting two. So from these two, it is written C. From these two molecule of glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, so it is giving us two molecule of next. So that is the step number 5, from which there is production of two molecules, not a single one. So glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate is now converted into 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate. The enzyme is glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate dehydrogenase. This is a dehydrogenase enzyme which is forming the 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate, and 2-NAD is converted into 2-NADH plus 2H plus. Sixth step, no energy is produced. Seventh step, in the seventh step, the 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate, two molecule, is converted into 3-phosphoglycerate, which is again two molecule. The enzyme is phosphoglycerate kinase. Here, this is the first step, that is step number seven, where we are gaining two molecules of ATP. How two molecules of ATP? Actually, since there is the production of two molecules of glycerol-3-phosphate, and all the things are produced two, that is multiple times, two times, not a single one. So actually there is production of one ATP from 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. Since there are two molecules of 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate there, so we are getting two ATPs. So this seventh step is the first step where the ATPs are producing. What is the next one? In the next step, these two molecules of, see, all these constituents are produced in two molecules, not a single one, two molecules after the production of glycerol-3-phosphate. Everything is produced two. So these two molecules of 3-phosphoglycerate is now converted into two molecules means two. The glucose, which is starting, the started molecule was one molecule. Step number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's all. Okay. After the step number 5, there is production of two molecules. Everything is two. Glycerol-3-phosphate 2, 3-phosphoglycerate 2, phosphoglycerate 2. Even at the pyruvate is also two molecules, not a single one. So in the step number 8, with the action of the enzyme phosphoglycerate mutase, this 3-phosphoglycerate is converted into 2-phosphoglycerate. 2-phosphoglycerate means at the second position. So 2-phosphoglycerate. Step number 8. What is the next? Obviously, step number 9, where the enolase enzyme converts these 2-phosphoglycerate molecules into the phosphoenol pyruvate with the release of 2 molecules of H2O. 2 molecules from 2. So that is 2 molecules. So 2-phosphoglycerate in the step number 9, with the action of enzyme enolase, with the release of 2H2, it is converted into phosphoenol pyruvate. Last one, that is last step, step number 10. So in the step number 10, this phosphoenol pyruvate is converted into the pyruvate with the action of enzyme pyruvate kinase and 2 ATP is forming. That is the last step. So in the step number 1 and 3, we require the use of 2 ATP. 2 ATP is lost, and in the step number 7 and 10, 2 ATP is forming. So since there are two molecules, so 4 ATPs are forming and 2 ATPs are lost. So the net gain is the 2 ATP that I told in the beginning, that we require some ATP and we are using, gaining some ATP, but the sum total is we are in the gaining position. So actually we are gaining 2 ATPs at the end of complete oxidation of one molecule of glucose, not the complete oxidation. That is not the complete oxidation, that is oxidation up to the pyruvate. Next pyruvate will proceed, enter into TC and some other cycle, and it will give us the energy. So that is the, now see, our time is almost over, just two minutes more. So that is the our glycolytic pathway. You all know the structures are also given. You may give the structure in the exam or may not, but you have to write all this enzyme name, all these reactions and everything. What is there? These are the simple thing, how the glucose will enter. See, some GLUT transporters are there. This transporter is helping in binding this glucose at the extracellular site. Then this transporter will transport this glucose to the intercellular site. Thereby the glucose will enter inside the cell. This is some kinetic properties of hexokinase is showing. That means the hexokinase, few types are there, hexokinase 1 or hexokinase 4. When the glucose concentration is increasing, the hexokinase 4 is responding okay. But the enzyme activity is highest in case of hexokinase 1. So here in the glucose also, that glycolysis, the hexokinase activity is showing. The 4, the hexokinase which is 4, hexokinase 4, this is having less relative enzyme activity. But the hexokinase 1 is having quick enzyme activity, relatively very, very high enzyme activity. That is hexokinase 1. Then the preparatory phase of glycolysis, first 2 ATP molecule are produced. Phosphofructokinase is there, not produced. 2 ATP molecules are required. Phosphofructokinase is generating. It is regulated by allosteric mechanism. That is, if ATP will bind, that phosphofructokinase enzyme will activate, and it will convert fructose 6 phosphate to fructose 1 6 bisphosphate. Then the activity of the aldolase enzyme is given there. I have already told that, which convert fructose 1 6 bisphosphate into 2 either dihydroxyacetone phosphate 1 glyceraldehyde 1 1 1 molecule. So from this step number 5 or 6, step number 6, we are getting 2 molecules of both. We have started with 1 molecule of glucose, and after coming to the step number 5, we are getting 2 molecules, everything. Energy production, it is giving phosphoenol pyruvate, it is giving PGA, then it is giving us pyruvate ATP in the form of NADH. All these are energy given substances, and that will give us the energy by next step. Phosphoglycerate kinase enzyme is also given, which converts 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate to 3 phosphoglycerate, then phosphoenol pyruvate to pyruvate. All reactions I have told you. These are the overall reactions of glycolysis. Actually, this is showing the free energy change, delta G. Delta G is the free energy change calculated from the actual concentration of the glycolytic intermediates present. Okay, that's all for today's class. If you are having any queries, any question, you can write in the comment section. I thank you all.